Now, Moody's has assigned first-time ratings to three mid-tier Nigerian banks: First City Monument Bank, Fidelity Bank, and Diamond Bank, which account for about 12% of Nigeria's banking assets. Akintunde Majekodunmi, Vice President and Banking Analyst at Moody's, joins us now online from London to discuss the ratings. Akintunde, thank you for taking the time out to join us today. Let's start with you talking us through the key drivers of the ratings decision on these three banks.
Sure. Thank you very much, Esther, for having me on the show. So we've assigned B2 local currency deposit ratings for FCMB and Fidelity, and a B3 local currency deposit rating for Diamond Bank. Now, for FCMB and Fidelity, these ratings are aligned with the government of Nigeria rating of B2. Now, the rating drivers for all three banks are the bank's robust capital buffers. Now, when I say robust buffers, I'm looking at this in isolation of any sort of regulatory minima. These capital buffers compare favorably against similarly rated banks globally. Secondly, and like other banking institutions in Nigeria, these are deposit-funded institutions. And for FCMB and Fidelity, FCMB and Diamond specifically, a large portion of deposits are retail deposits, which we consider sticky deposits. So this is positive. Additionally, from a local currency perspective, these banks exhibit very strong local currency buffers, liquidity buffers, that is. Now, these strengths are balanced against the still challenging operating environment. Although Nigeria is recovering from its recession in 2016, the recovery is still generally quite slow. So there's still a dearth of lending opportunities for banks. And for existing borrowers, the corporate environment is still quite difficult. So that has some asset quality implications for banks. Now, the last thing I want to mention is the reason why the Diamond rating is one notch below that of Fidelity. For Fidelity and FCMB, the reason behind that is the current asset quality challenges Diamond is currently going through, and the fact that the bank is exhibiting modest foreign currency liquidity. However, going forward, we do see this improving for Diamond in terms of asset quality, and we expect the bank's NPLs to drop over the next 12 to 18 months.
Okay, let's talk about the bank's exposure to foreign currency risk, something that was also highlighted in your note. As stated in your note, FCMB, for instance, has 55% of its loan book was dominated in foreign currency. That was as at December of 2017. Now, this leaves the bank's loan performance especially vulnerable to currency risk. Help us understand how you see the bank hedging against this risk going forward.
Sure. You mentioned FCMB, but Fidelity and Diamond as well, they also have a large proportion of their foreign currency or their gross loans denominated in foreign currency. On average, the three banks have about 50% of their gross loans denominated in foreign currency. But this isn't really too dissimilar to other Nigerian banks. It is slightly higher than the banking system average, which is about 41%, but the banking system average is still quite high. Now, in a lot of our research, we've written about the Nigerian banking system, and on several occasions on this show, I've mentioned the risks associated with foreign currency loans. And really, they're twofold. One is the asset quality challenges that your foreign currency portfolio can generate, because when the Naira depreciates, this can put pressure for borrowers that have borrowed in foreign currency but earn in Naira. And for example, we saw this happen with Nine Mobile. Now, secondly, there's some implications for capital. Depreciating Naira will moderate a bank's capital, because as the Naira depreciates, your risk-weighted assets that are denominated in foreign currency grow, and this shrinks your capital metrics. So those are the two sources of risk, if you like, on account of a bank's exposure to foreign currency loans. But I just want to mention that these two factors have already been incorporated in our current ratings for all banks in Nigeria.
Now, you mentioned capital. Let's quickly talk about that. The part of the report also says that limited capacity, capacity to grow profitability given declining yield on government securities here in Nigeria is one of the factor, one of the factors mentioned in the note. Of course, you also talked about the difficult operating environment. Now, to what extent will this limit profit retention for capital growth for these three banks?
Sure. You're correct. We do think there's going to be continued pressure on banking profitability across the board. A reason for this is the decline in government yield, and the banks are heavily exposed to government securities. Secondly, the cost of risk for banks is likely to stay quite high, especially now given the introduction of a more stricter provisioning rules under IFRS 9. So we do expect some pressure on bank profits going forward. Having said this, for many of the banks, specifically FCMB and Fidelity in this case, we do expect that the bank's pre-provision income will continue to absorb the cost of risk emanating from their loan portfolio. So that's why we expect capital to be supported still at this bank, and we don't expect any capital erosion from impaired assets, as it were.
All right, just one last question. You mentioned IFRS 9. I was going to talk about that. We saw that, taking effect from the beginning of this year in January, and I wanted to just hear your thoughts on how banks are adjusting to it, especially between or making comparisons between the tier ones and the tier twos, how those two categories are responding to having to make that special provision in ahead for loans, for bad loans.
Sure. I wouldn't say there's any major differentiation between the tiers of banks. If you've listened to the investor calls from the banks and talked to management directly, most banks are expecting a negative impact on capital and an increased cost of risk, as I mentioned. For capital, mostly management are saying anywhere between 70 to 150 basis points reduction in capital on account of IFRS 9 and also a hike in the cost of risk. But most management haven't actually given a forecast of that. So the implications are twofold, a reduction in capital and an increase in the cost of risk for these banks.
Well, Akintunde, thank you so much for sharing that with us today. Akintunde Majekodunmi, Vice President and Banking Analyst at Moody's.